So let's have a look at the configuration. The way we're going to do it is we're going to create a network load balancer. We're going to have a target group with two instances, each in a different availability zone. And in each of those AZs, we're going to have an Elastic IP address. And that's what's going to be associated with the load balancer. So the load balancer nodes that get deployed into the availability zones are going to be resolvable by this IP address. Now, what does that mean? That means our client here is able to create a rule that says it's going to allow outbound traffic to these two IP addresses. Now remember, the NLB has a DNS name, and the DNS name is going to resolve two IP addresses, and those are the IP addresses of the nodes. Now normally, those would be dynamically assigned, so they would be public addresses because this is a public-facing load balancer, but they wouldn't be IP addresses that you could rely on because they might change as nodes change. So in this case, we'll have static addresses. Now, what is this client going to be? Well, what we'll do is we're going to launch an EC2 instance in another account. And from that account, we're going to create a security group that allows outbound HTTP and only to these IP addresses. And it will be a Linux instance, and we'll simply run the curl command from the command line and make sure that we can retrieve the web page. So that's how it works. Let's head over to the console. I'm in the AWS management console and I've connected to my production account. Now you can choose whatever region you want. For me, it's sometimes a bit easier to go to Sydney, so I get a bit less latency. So in Sydney, if I scroll down to auto scaling groups, I already have my auto scaling group here that we created earlier on. And what I'm going to simply do is just edit the auto scaling group, and I'm going to set each of these values to 2. Now the auto scaling group has been configured across multiple availability zones, so we should find that each instance gets launched into a different AZ. Now those instances will have an IAM role attached to them, and we also configured user data, so this was back in the hands-on lesson for auto scaling. We set it up so that it will actually boot up, use the user data to pull a file from S3 and create a web page. And that web page will tell us the availability zone that the instance is in. So while that's happening, we can scroll down, go to load balancers and choose create load balancer. I'm going to choose a network load balancer. Call this one my NLB. The IP address can be IPv4. Load balancer protocol is TCP, port 80, that's fine. Then we can choose VPC and the availability zones. Now, what we then have is options to get an IP address from AWS or assign an Elastic one, but we don't have an Elastic one yet. So actually what I've got to do is cancel back out of here. Just scroll down to network and security, Elastic IPs. And we simply need to allocate two Elastic IPs. So we just click on allocate, and that's 1. Click on allocate again, and that's 2. So if I clear my filters, I've got 2 Elastic IPs. Now let's come back to load balancers, create load balancer, network load balancer, call it my NLB. And now we should be able to go through that same process and actually choose the Elastic IP. So we'll choose one of those, and we'll choose one here. So now we have an Elastic IP in 2 different availability zones. So let's click on next, through to routing, and we're going to create a new target group. And that's going to be called TG-NLB. I'm going to leave the remaining settings as defaults, go to register targets, add my 2 targets, and we can see they are deployed in different availability zones, A and C. Add those to registered, click on next, and then click on create. So that's now being created, so we'll give that a few minutes to actually provision. I gave that a few minutes and it's now active. And I just want to go and check my instances as well. So let's just click on these instances. We've got 2 running ones. Copy the public IP, and in a new browser window, I'm going to paste that in and we can see that this particular instance is an AP Southeast 2C. So now let's just come back, copy the IP of our other instance, put that in the browser, and let's see. And that one's in 2A. So great, we've got those two working. Now let's come back to our load balancer. And if we copy this DNS name, and let's go over to a command prompt, and what I'm going to do is run the NS lookup utility, and then paste in the DNS name, and we get a returned IP address here, and that's one of our Elastic IPs. Sometimes it will return both. In this case, it's just returned one address, but that's the Elastic IP address, so that's a static IP. So that's good, that's all set up correctly. That means what should happen is if I run curl from my command line here, then it should return the web page, and you can see the text here that's come from one of the instances, the one in 2A. Now, don't worry if you're on Windows and you don't have curl, because we're going to do this from an EC2 instance in a separate account, and that's where we're going to configure the whitelisting configuration. So what I'll do now is from production, I'm going to flick across to development. And what I'm going to do here is launch an EC2 instance. So let's launch an instance, Linux 2 AMI. It's going to be a T2 micro. We can leave all of the defaults here, click on next, and then go through to security group. And we don't have a security group here, so let's create one. Let's just create one called web access, as we typically do. And I'm happy with just having SSH at this stage. So we've got that coming from any source. Let's review and launch, and then launch. And I have a key pair selected. So let's just launch that instance. Once the instance is launched, I want you to connect into the EC2 instance, and then we'll have a look at how we can set up the security group in a bit more detail. So I've connected into my instance, and I'm simply going to run curl, and I've got my load balancer DNS name. So we know that's working. Let's also run dig and see what IPs get returned. And again, we're getting this IP address. So we're having this one particular IP address returned. So I'm copying that to my clipboard, and then I'm going to come back to EC2 in my dev account, go to security groups, and then let's go to web access, outbound rules, and we're going to change the outbound rule. So rather than having this all traffic rule, we're going to have one that's custom for HTTP, and it's going to only allow to this particular destination, /32. So we can remove this rule, and then we can save rules. So that's been updated. So let's have a look now and make sure we can still connect. So I'm going to run curl, put in the DNS name of the NLB, and sure enough, we have a return here. Now, even though this is fairly simple setup, I just wanted to show you this because it does come up in exam questions. So the key thing to remember here is what I've done is I've actually just allowed only one IP address outbound. So I've allowed that in my rule set. So imagine you're working in a company environment. You need to connect to a load balancer somewhere else, or clients need to connect to you, and they only want to whitelist certain IP addresses for whatever protocol you're using. And therefore, you can use this technique of using an Elastic IP. So that's all we need to do here. I'm simply going to terminate this instance. And then let's clean up by going back to the prod account as well. And there's a couple of things to do here. So firstly, let's go and delete our load balancer. So let's get rid of that one. Just delete our load balancer. Let's go to auto scaling groups. And we're going to reset this again, which means we're just going to edit, put it back to zeros, and update. And that should terminate our instances. And then the very last thing to do is don't forget the Elastic IPs. These will cost you money if you don't delete these. You've got to wait until your load balancer is deleted before you're allowed to do this. And then you should be able to come back in and release the Elastic IPs. And those are gone from your account. So that's it for this lesson. Hope you enjoyed that. I'll see you in the next lesson.